In Vietnam, the highest person ever even accused of anything was Lieutenant Cowley in the My Lai massacre, and he was either pardoned or whatever by Nixon. Nobody higher than that has ever been accused, tried, or imprisoned for war crimes in America. As a matter of fact, Vietnam had to pay us back reparations. And we illegally invaded and occupied and destroyed their country, and they had to pay us reparations. That's one of the things that led to World War II. The oppressive sanctions on Germany. Germany wasn't even invited to the Treaty of Versailles. And nobody in America has ever been held accountable for these crimes. That's why we keep on getting in war after war after war after war. And the congressional committee that investigated, I almost said George Bush, Richard Nixon, well, they tried to write an article of impeachment that dealt with the illegal bombings of Cambodia and Laos. But the committee at the end decided to take that clause out. Liz Holzman and Father Dryden, and one other guy I can't think of, wrote that clause. And you have to wonder why. Why were they going to impeach Nixon but not include his war crimes? Because I believe that most of them are war criminals. And when you get to that high level, Democrats and Republicans, most of them are in the same pockets. And conversely, they get their pockets lined by the same people. And war is systemic in our country. The Democrats and Republicans are the war party, most of them. We have some really good on both sides that have been very courageous and heroic about this war. So this time, somebody has to be held accountable for this mess. Maybe if we had held Nixon, Johnson, McNamara, Kissinger, any of the other war criminals accountable, Casey might still be alive. 3,290-something other Americans might still be alive. And hundreds of thousands of innocent Iraqis might be alive. Because maybe they would be slow to get in these conflicts if they knew that they may be held accountable for them. And I don't believe that George Bush and Dick Cheney and the rest of their criminal cabal should just be impeached. I believe they should be removed from office. I believe they should be indicted. I believe they should be sent to The Hague to be tried for crimes against humanity. I said that in Venezuela once, and I thought they were going to canonize me. Actually, I'll tell a story. I was at the World Social Forum event in Caracas last January, and I was speaking to a crowd that was like hundreds of thousands of people. I'd never seen so much people. I'd never spoken to a crowd that was so large, and they're very energetic. Latin American audiences are awesome. They dance, they play instruments, but they listen very attentively. And I was speaking and I was being translated. Well, at the end of my speech, I always try to leave my foreign audiences with hope that most of Americans disapprove of what's going on. They can't really tell because they don't see millions of Americans protesting. And I just want to guarantee you one thing, that if George Bush was president of any other country or prime minister of any other country, he would still not be president or prime minister of that country. People would have risen up and overthrown him. And anyway, I was telling him, you can rest assured there's people in America like me who are working very hard to have George Bush impeached. And my translator said that, and the crowd was excited about it. And then I said, but we're not going to stop there, because after he's impeached, she also has to be removed from office. And my translator translated that, the crowd got even more excited. And then I said, and after that, he has to go to prison for war crimes. Yeah. And so my translator said that, and the crowd went insane. They were like, Viva Cindy, Viva Cindy! Jumping up and down, screaming. Like, all right, I kicked ass here. Like, all excited. And then it was, after a week, I was leaving Caracas, and I had already got to America, but hadn't gone through customs yet. And this lady ran up to me. She said, Cindy, I was in Venezuela at the social farm. I said, oh, yeah, so was I. She was like, no. I saw you speak there. And I went, what time? And she goes, oh, at the big rally. And I said, wasn't that great? The crowd was so excited. And she goes, yeah, but let me tell you why. She goes, I speak Spanish. I'm bilingual. And I was like, okay, so what happened? And she said, when you said impeach, your translator said impeach. When you said remove from office, your translator said remove from office. But when you said in prison for war crimes, your translator said executed. You know, but then I realized, you know what, in many states, including George Bush's state, execution is legal. You know, who was the main executioner? George Bush. George Bush executed mentally challenged people. You know, George Bush never gave one pardon, executed something like 134 people while he was governor. I mean, this man is addicted to killing, and all Congress wants to do is give him more money to fuel his addiction.
Alberto checked out all the executions.
Yes, Alberto Gonzalez always gave George Bush a one page, probably in 20 font, double spaced summary of the, yeah, so. Alberto Gonzalez is in deep trouble too. So, you know, this administration is just so corrupt. Corrupt through and through. They erased something like 5 million emails. You can't erase emails. You know, even I know that. You know, you can bet if they wanted to find an email I wrote, they would find it like that. You know, like Patrick Leahy said, my 13-year-old neighbor could go and find those emails for me. And I want all 5 million of those emails recovered and read. Yeah. Every single one of them. You know, it's just like those minutes missing from Richard Nixon's tape. You know, these people are so criminal and so corrupt. And I got an email today when I sent out the email about the missing emails. And I received an email back, and the lady's like, yeah, Cindy, maybe this will be the what did she call it? Their final nail in the coffin or something like that. And I said, how many nails do these people get? You know, how many get out of jail free cards does George Bush get? And Dick Cheney, especially Dick Cheney. Why is he still there after the Scooter Libby stuff? You know, well, we have to impeach them simultaneously. Because we know what happened with Richard Nixon. You know, Spiro Agnew had to resign, and he appointed his lackey, Gerald Ford. And that really disgusted me after Ford died. I'm sure his family loved him. You know, but everybody's saying, oh, he healed the nation. What a bunch of crap. Healing of the nation would have entailed some kind of accountability against the criminals. And he pardoned Nixon, let Nixon go scot-free. That's not healing. That's not justice. That's not the American way. So Nixon goes, nothing was healed. We didn't get healed. We went into at least a decade-long coma. After Vietnam, after Richard Nixon, at least a decade. We thought the Clinton years were the golden years. And Clinton was participating in massive crimes against humanity. You know, he should have been impeached, but not for what he was impeached for. You know, and they were saying, oh, what a great healer Gerald Ford was. And if he really healed the nation, we wouldn't have gotten George Bush. That's why George Bush has to be held accountable. You know, George Bush is not the problem. George Bush is just a symptom of the problem. One time I was talking at a church somewhere, and it just popped in my head, and usually I just say stuff that pops in my head, huh, Lubba? There's not much of a filter. And I said, you know, George, I was talking about this. I said, George Bush is just a symptom. George Bush is just a boil on the ass of democracy. And if you lance that boil, another boil is just gonna pop up. And that's all we've been doing, is lancing the boils. You know, sometimes they just walk away scot-free. You know, George Herbert Walker Bush, what a criminal. That Bush crime family, members of the Carlyle Group, Neil Bush, Silverado Savings, Barbara Bush investing in Katrina relief as long as it went to Neil Bush's company. Neil Bush profits off the No Child Left Behind Act. He also arranges for defense contractors to get contracts. All these people do is rape America of its treasure and its human treasure. They don't give anything back to the country. They just take, take, take. You know, and they just walk away. They walk away to their fabulous lives and their mansions. Sometimes like George Herbert Walker to consult for defense contractors. And we get another boil. And this is the same problem. We have to cure the disease. We have to cure the disease that causes these boils on our asses of democracy. And one of the diseases is this rampant militarism that our country is in. You know, we are, by definition, at least by another fascist dictator's definition, a fascist state. Mussolini said fascism could rightly be called corporatism because it's the marriage of state and corporations. And what has happened? Our government controls the media. The media is just propaganda tools for the government. And the five entities that own the media, they're all war profiteers. So they all have a stake in keeping this war going. Nancy Pelosi, she not only gets money from Raytheon, she invests in Raytheon. That's a clear conflict of interest. Dianne Feinstein's husband has been awarded millions, his companies, two defense contractors, awarded millions of dollars in contracts. That's a clear conflict of interest. The war machine has a stranglehold on our country. It has a stranglehold on our economy. Every tax dollar that we give to this government goes to the Defense Department paying off previous wars. That's why I refuse to pay my taxes. I was in a coma after Vietnam, after the Nixon regime. I was still really young. I was a young mother. I wanted to protect my children. And when I realized that my support of this government with my tax dollars helped kill my son and helped kill many millions of people, I said that the United States government is not getting one more penny from me. I don't support what they do. George Bush hasn't done one thing right. Can anybody name something positive he's done since he's been president? I have $10 in my pocket. I'll give it to you if you can name something positive he's done.
Caught a purge.
He what?
He caught a purge.
Oh, he caught a purge. Remember that time he flicked some brush too? So, but that purge had a family. You know, and many of us are amazing peace activists. Many of us, of you, have been doing it for a lot longer than I've been doing it. Your whole entire adult life has been consumed with the quest for peace. But I think it's a little, maybe hypocritical is too strong a word, but to give your tax dollars to this government to do what they're doing. You know, we already pay taxes. We pay taxes for the roads that we drive on. We pay sales tax. Those are value taxes. You know, we get what we pay for. But when we give the government our taxes, we're giving them permission to use our tax dollars for their crimes against humanity. I was having an interview one time, and the interviewer says, "Cindy, you don't want Congress to give George Bush more money to wage war, but you pay your taxes." I said, "No, I don't. I refuse to pay my taxes for this." So I can say that with a clear conscience.
How do we do that? I mean, everybody in this room has to sign W-2s to your employer, and they'll, you know, the law is the gun pointed to your head.
Well, you know, I say you have to really investigate it before you do it yourself. But you can sign a W-2, you can claim up to 9 exemptions, and you not have to pay any withholding. You know, it's a very brave thing to do. But I consider it a moral choice. And I would not condemn anybody for doing it because it's a moral choice. You know, it's as personal and moral choices, I believe, as abortion. You know, it ranks up there with moral choices, and it's up to you to look in your heart and ask yourself, do you want to fund their crimes against humanity? What I think we should do with our tax money is set up a peace fund, like a scholarship fund for people who want to go to college, but their only opportunity is to join the military. Wouldn't that be nice if there was some kind of peace fund? That we could grant scholarships to those people for. And we can use that peace fund also to support war resistors. As here, I've heard it over and over again. Your son volunteered. Like, that gives George Bush permission to misuse him. You know, like Casey got what he was asking for because he volunteered. Well, if they volunteer and they belong to a volunteer organization, they should be able to unvolunteer without going to prison. You know, when the mission changes, they should be able to go on their own. None of these kids signed up to invade and occupy a country that was no threat to the United States of America. Most of them signed up because they saw no alternative, because of this deep-rooted militaristic society we have, where college is so exorbitant, only the elite can afford it without having to break their backs or break the backs of their parents. It's very difficult to go to college here in America. People say, "Cindy, why aren't the college students out?" I say, because the ones who really care are working full time to help pay for college, and they're trying to just to survive. And the rest of them are the children of the elite who are profiting off of what's going on. So that's why we don't see a big uprising on campuses. But I do more and more see young faces out there. So first of all, in the public education system, now when we have no child left behind, they don't get music education, they don't get critical thinking education, none of the arts. The teachers have to teach to those tests that are provided to us by Neil Bush's, you know, education company. So they get to college, it's so expensive they can't afford it. So what do they want to do? Do they want to flip burgers their whole life? Or do they want to join the military and listen to their recruiters who tell them what a wonderful adventure it is? It's not just a job, it's an adventure. You know, they tell them, oh, you can be a computer specialist. You can be a language specialist. You can be a spy. You can be in the Army band. You know, they told Casey you can travel. They told Casey he could be a chaplain's assistant, which is not the safest job in the Army, by the way. Because the chaplains are right there on the front lines and their assistants are right there protecting them if they have to give last rites. But that's what Casey wanted to do. He was promised he could do that. He gets to boot camp and they say, oh, well, we're just kidding. You know, that specialty is filled. You can be a Humvee mechanic or a cook. You know, so these kids are lied to by the recruiters. They see it as a way out of their communities where they have no opportunities in their communities. And we need to change that paradigm. You know, we're spending $10 million an hour in Iraq. How many students can go for free to this school with 1 hour of Iraq? You know, with the rest of the countries in the world, if our children want to and if they qualify, they should be able to have a college education for free. That's never going to happen because the war machine needs ignorant cannon fodder. So there's so many things in this society we could cure. Has anybody ever read that treatise, War is a Racket, by Major General Smedley Darlington Butler? Okay, yeah. Give it up for Smedley. Smedley Butler was the most decorated Marine in history. He's like a god to Marines. But many Marines don't know he was a Quaker. You know, they don't know that he wrote this treatise on war profiteering right after World War I. And he has a cure for war profiteering. In times of war, a president, a senator, a congressperson, a CEO of a war profiting company, workers in that company, can only make as much as a soldier on the ground. Even workers for Blackwater make more in 2 days than our soldiers make an entire month. So if that were true, I think war would stop.
Yeah.
Did you know that the major war profiteers, before the war, the average bonus was $350 million? Now it's $750 million? You know, Congress says we have to give George Bush the money to support the troops. Not supporting the troops, they're supporting the war profiteers. Our troops still aren't getting what they need. They have this surge, sending 20,000, 25,000, 30,000 more troops to Baghdad. They don't get body armor till the summer. So they have to dodge IEDs and bullets or something till the summer. To me, they come home and the VA system is falling apart. And they're taking money out of the VA system to balance the budget. They're balancing the budgets off the very people that their policies directly have damaged. They're balancing the budget off of our children. They're balancing the budget off our unborn children and grandchildren. And not only that, their policies are making the world a far more dangerous place for us and our children to live in.
They're raping the world.
They are. That's what they're totally doing, and that's what Bushes do. You know, if we lance George Bush, that will go far towards curing the problem, because really the Bushes have been raping and murdering for generations. Prescott Bush was a Nazi sympathizer. And I'm going to close this part of my talk with just a quick story. Before Camp Casey, it was about May of 2005. So I had already founded Gold Star Families for Peace. I was going all over the country talking, just like I do now. Yeah, I was doing exactly what I was doing, except, you know, not as big of crowds. You know, I was paying my own way. Now usually people pay my way. But I was still really active. Some of you might have seen me testify at John Conyers after, Downing Street memo hearings where we were in the basement. And I was with Joe Wilson and Ray McGovern and a constitutional specialist, John Boniface, and we all testified in the basement. I lied and told two stories. And so I got a message on my MySpace page. I'm so cool, I have a MySpace page. And I have like almost 6,000 friends. I have like, Michael Moore only has like 700 friends. And I have and Michael Moore is one of my best friends, one of my top friends. You know, it's really a great way to reach out to young people. I've gotten so many young people involved in the movement through my MySpace page. But anyway, I got a message. This guy was in Colorado yesterday, and it was some other summit, and Joe Wilson, Ambassador Joe Wilson, was speaking. And he was talking about the lawsuit that they have against the government and against George Bush. And he said that with the money they get, they're going to give it to other people who similarly want to sue the government. But if they get the ranch, they're going to give it to me. Yeah, that would be a great veteran center. Well, because that's what I'm going to make my 5 acres into, a veterans therapeutic center. And we're going to do therapeutic farming to help veterans transition from war and their families transition from war to a society that really doesn't even know that we're out of war. You know, so that's what we're doing. And if we can have the pig farm, or the pigs farm as I like to call it, we could like really do great things. And what a fitting karma to use his land to help vets that he's harmed. You know, I just think, so keep your fingers crossed that the Wilsons get that land so they can give it to me. What other story was I going to tell? I was talking about the Downing Street. Oh, yeah. So in about May of that year, the Downing Street memo hearings were in June. In January, we had tried to have a meeting, some Gold Star families, when we first started our organization. We tried to have a meeting with Donald Rumsfeld. We faxed, we emailed, we got a hold of a scheduler. You know, at first they were taking our calls and they wouldn't take our calls or answer our emails or our faxes from Gold Star families. So we decided on the day before our inauguration that we would just go to the Pentagon and demand a meeting. And there was like five bereaved families, some vets, some military families, some Iraq vets, some Vietnam vets. We get up to the parking lot, we were stopped by like a battalion of police, Pentagon police in riot gear. So anyway, after that point, my congressman, George Miller, who is basically a good guy, but now that Nancy Pelosi has become Speaker of the House, he's Nancy's enforcer. You know, he goes around and tells people, you better vote for that supplemental with Nancy's bill on it. You know, the Nancy's get out eventually bill attached to the supplemental that George Bush warned them that he would veto anyway. You know, and I don't know why they didn't believe him and they're going to send him this stupid bill. I think he should veto it. I think it's a really dumb bill. But anyway, I went to meet with George. And several other Congress people sent Rumsfeld a letter. And his office worked really hard to try and get me a meeting with him. So I went and visited George in his home district in California, George Miller. And we were talking, and it was really irritating to me because I would ask him a question, and he would answer my husband. And I'd say, over here. I'm the one that just asked you the question. He just came along. And I'm the one that wants answers. And so finally I said, George, why aren't you Democrats doing anything? Why aren't you being true opposition to the Republicans? He said, oh, Cindy, we're in a minority. You don't understand politics. And I said, I'll tell you what I do understand. I do understand that the Bush crime family has been killing people for generations. And when they killed my son, they killed the wrong person. And I won't rest until I get answers to my questions, until he's held accountable. And you know what, George? I'm only one person. You know, this is what gets me. We, in the anti-war peace movement, are the overwhelming majority in this country. We outrank or outnumber the pro-war, anti-peace movement double. We double them. But you would think in Indiana they were the majority. Because you know what? They're loud. They think if they're loud, it doesn't matter how stupid they are. As long as they're loud. George Bush thinks if he repeats things over and over again, it doesn't matter how stupid he is, that they'll sound smart. We have to realize that it is not shameful to be a liberal. It's not shameful to be a progressive. And there's certainly nothing loony about working for peace. Everybody should want peace. And I told George, I'm only one person, but trust me, I will be the opposition that you won't be. And so I saw him right after Camp Casey in Washington, D.C., and I said, do you remember the meeting we had in your home district? I was one person. You were one person in a caucus of people. You know, the Republicans didn't ever have an overwhelming majority in the House. If the Democrats had stood up to them, then I wouldn't have had to go down to Crawford, Texas, and sweat in the ditches for 26 days. You know, I figured if the media won't do it, or Congress won't ask that question, I'll go down. I have a voice. I can ask that question. All of you have voices. You know, there during that summer was Cindy speaks for me, Cindy doesn't speak for me. I was like, you all have voices. Speak for yourself. You know, you may agree with what I'm saying, but don't leave me to be the only one saying it. And if the Cindy doesn't speak for me people, I don't, but if I did, you'd sound a lot smarter. You know, so we all have voices. We all have gifts and talents. Not everybody's able to travel and meet with hundreds of people, you know, almost on a daily basis, or thousands of people like I am able to do. Not everybody has a gift of writing like I have. But you all have something to offer, and you all have your own voice. And you have to look at yourself and say, there's only one Cindy Sheehan in the world. I was at Vermont, and one old lady goes, thank God! And you know, and no matter how hard you try, you're never going to be Cindy Sheehan. But I'm never going to be any one of you. Each one of us has something unique that we can offer to this movement and to humanity. But we can't cower and be afraid of people who I think now are intentionally going out of their way to avoid facts. If they go get it, then they really are working hard at remaining ignorant. So you are doing a wonderful job in Indiana. I've gone to places, hundreds of people coming out for peace, hundreds of people against the war, hundreds of people every place I go that want George Bush impeached and removed from office and the rest of his criminal cabal. I only have encountered a tiny protest, but if you look at the media, that's all you would think of. Am I pushing something in here? I'm putting you to sleep with it. Wow, pretty starfish. So you have to be proud of being for peace. You have to be proud of being for justice. You have to be proud for standing up for true American values. No torture, no wars of aggression, no imperialism, No spying on Americans without due process. No imprisoning Americans with no due process. No stinking, leaving Americans hanging off their roofs while you're golfing and eating birthday cake with John McCain or shopping for shoes in New York City. Katrina! Katrina only proved how disastrous and how vulnerable he made the United States of America by his policies. Those are true American values. And you have to stand up and be proud of it. And not shy away from the people who are only loud. That's all they have for them. That's the only thing they have going for them is that they're loud. You know what? We can be louder than they can be. But you know what? We also have truth on our side. And we have good on our side. And there's never been one time in history when evil has defeated good. And as long as there's one of us out there screaming for peace, then good is still winning. And I'm going to invite you to scream along with me and use our voices and drown out the voices of lies. Drown out the voices of oppression. Drown out the voices of injustice. And if we are all singing together, if we're singing the right tune, maybe this time we will cure the disease that causes the boils. Thank you.